That's his day. Carried me back to old Virginia. There's where the cotton.
Like other first families, the Carters' second generation proved to be their greatest. In fact, it could be rightly said that the Carters' second generation was the greatest of any generation from Virginia's first families. No other family produced a character who earned the moniker King than the Carters. And he certainly was King in Virginia. Robert King Carter dominated the colony during his generation more than any other figure between Governor Berkeley and the later arriving Founding Fathers. His dominance extended in many ways, economically, politically, and familially. Such was Carter's influence that I'd argue that he molded 18th century Virginia into his image, even if there were other power brokers who challenged otherwise. He was king among his peers, and he created a domestic empire that endured for many generations. Robert had many children, and those children benefited more from being Carter's progeny than anyone else on the first family list. They all received vast acreage, money, and slaves from Robert's will. That's even without mentioning the legacy of Robert's name that each child carried with them into his own generation. Though there were some bumps along the way, the Carter name really didn't fade into the past like some of the other first families on the list. They continued to produce stalwarts and historic influencers well into the future. Such was the Carter importance that I felt it necessary to cover them in an extra episode for this first family series. I trust you'll agree with my choice as we dive into this second Carter episode.
I was standing by the window on one cold and cloudy day, and I saw the hearse come rolling for to carry my mother away. Oh, can the circle be unbroken by and by?
Robert Carter was born in 1663 to John Carter and Sarah Ludlow. As we saw in the last episode, Robert wasn't the oldest child born to John. Robert was in fact the second born child to John and John's third wife, Sarah. He did have an older sister named Sarah, but Sarah died young, leaving Robert as the only surviving child from John's third marriage. The young Carter never really knew his father, because John died in 1670 when Robert was only 6 years old. This left the young boy in care of his older brother, John II. John II carried out his father's wishes by managing Robert's 1,000-acre plot. The elder John's will stated that, "My will is that my son Robert, during his minority, have a man or youth servant brought for him, that hath been brought up in the Latin school, and that he shall constantly tend upon him, not only to teach him his books either in English or Latin, according to his capacity, but also to preserve him from harm and from doing evil." John meant this, as we can see with his leaving many religious books to Robert in the same will. Once the younger John believed Robert was well enough educated by this tutor, John then moved into the second part of his father's will regarding Robert's education. In 1672, he arranged for Robert to travel to England, where he furthered his classical education at a formal English grammar school. He also reestablished the generations old family connection with the Baileys. Robert was to stay with Arthur Bailey, who, in addition to keeping Robert's classical education on track, would also train the young boy in the merchanting discipline. Bailey was a good choice, not only because of the family connections, but also because Arthur had once settled in Virginia for a time, and even served in the House of Burgesses before returning to England in the 1660s. Though Bailey had returned to England, he maintained a several-vessel-strong fleet, which was quite active in the Atlantic tobacco trade. Such activity kept him in close connection with the Carters, especially as Arthur served as the elder John's factor for some time. Either way, Robert lived with the Baileys at their Upper Shadwell home in Stepney Parish, London, for the next 6 years. He most likely attended Mile End Grammar School, where he endured a rigorous education. At the same time, the vibrant London scene impressed upon a young Robert the need for vigorous action in order to organize and manage a productive transatlantic business. It wasn't an Oxford or Cambridge-style education, but what Robert did learn certainly set him up for unprecedented New World success. That success allowed him to set up future academic pursuits by not only those in his own family, but also others in the colony as well. In fact, it was a goal of Carter's to, as he said in a letter to Francis Lee, see Virginia represented by a, quote, set of better polished patriots. Part of Carter's legacy in this matter was certainly felt in Virginia's leading role during the Revolutionary era, as so many of those later leaders benefited from Carter's influence. Though academic learning remained somewhat important to Carter throughout his life, practical intelligence took control of his outlook after returning to Virginia. Many other first family sons stayed in England to matriculate at various institutions of higher learning. But for a reason unknown to us, Robert chose to end his overseas adventure in 1679. He'd learned much while under the Bailey's care, but at age 15 or 16, Robert returned to Corotoman and began a new type of education under his older half-brother John. John had been managing Robert's thousand-acre bequest, while also managing his own property as well as the properties of other semi-related peoples in Virginia's Tidewater region. Life was certainly different than what Robert had experienced back in London. Post-Bacon's Rebellion, Virginia began experiencing changes that would affect Robert and Virginia's future. For one, Robert was on hand for John's brief jaunt into politics. He was also around for John's marrying second wife, Elizabeth, who would have been the predominant female figure for the young adult Robert. By the 1680s, planters like the Carters had turned to practicing volume farming, which meant that huge acreages were planted. Those large land tracts required increasingly more labor, something that the up-until-then indentured servant market was able to handle. This new practice, however, accompanied with post-Bacon Rebellion fallout, as well as the coming end of the headright system, meant that the newly rising planter class needed to find new methods in order to support their volume farming practices. This is the first issue in which we find Robert's name listed in Virginia's record after Robert's return from London. He was seen handling John's indentured servants in 1684. He'd apparently acquitted himself well enough to be able to step out on his own by 1688. John's health might have aided this activity given that John was frequently ill during the 1680s, before his ultimate 1690 demise. In 1688, Robert wed Gloucester County planter and leader John Armistead of Hesse's daughter, Judith. They moved back to Corotoman, where Robert began building a permanent brick dwelling on the plantation. Perhaps this move was a bit aggressive, or perhaps it was prescient given John's health, as well as John having only a surviving daughter for whom to will his property. That daughter, Elizabeth, was only 12 when Robert married Judith, and 14 at the time of John's death. John's will stipulated that his property could only pass to a surviving male heir, or it would devolve to the next of kin male, in this case, Robert. To smooth out the details, Robert saw to it that Elizabeth quickly married John Lloyd, a loosely related stepson of Elizabeth's grandmother on the Hull side of the family tree. The new couple then moved to his land in Richmond County, but Elizabeth sadly died from the measles by 1693. The next potential hurdle facing Robert's inheriting all of the Carter legacy was his sister-in-law Elizabeth, who remained at Corotoman after John's death, until she took the small bequest left to her by first husband John into her new marriage with Rosegill's Christopher Wormley. The Wormleys, at least Christopher, didn't go quietly. He and his wife sued Robert for what they deemed to be their share of John Carter's estate. But his new bride died childless in 1691. Thus, any real claim Christopher might have had on Carter lands evaporated. This didn't stop Robert from retaining legal services from one Charles Harris. Harris aided the now 30-year-old Carter heir, at least until after his niece Elizabeth's 1693 death. By that time, Robert was the certain heir to all lands descending from his father and older brother. He then quickly set about turning already considerable holdings into the most dominant colonial empire Virginia had ever seen. Robert ended up with 6,000 acres of land once all of the legal issues surrounding the Carter estate were settled. To work that many acres, Carter needed many people. He did inherit slaves from his father and brother, but indentured servants from the British Isles featured most prominently on Carter lands early on. That began to change as the price to secure passage across the Atlantic proved to be higher for indentured servants than it was to purchase permanent labor from slaves. Additionally, in Carter's as well as other planters' minds from the era, slaves didn't have an expiration date on their labor like the indentures did. With severe price drops affecting tobacco sales, planters like Carter looked for alternatives. One alternative was to plant ever larger tracts of land with lower quality tobacco. The other was to purchase a more affordable, longer-lasting workforce. Certainly, modern Americans shudder at such thinking. The English, to an extent, did as well, considering they viewed slavery as something dirty that the Spanish and Portuguese did. As time progressed, the stigma surrounding slavery began to disappear, especially as more English colonies began instituting the practice. Contrary to contemporary opinion, Virginia was not the first colony to institute the practice. New Jersey, New York, and Massachusetts had legal precedents on their records decades before the term slave was even used in the Old Dominion. By the time Robert Carter's era arrived, slavery had been in practice outside of Virginia for almost 5 decades. Within the colony, there were a handful of cases, but it wasn't until 1705 that chattel slavery became legally enforced. At that date, Robert was undeniably involved in codifying the practice, as he had already been a slave owner for 20 years and ranked highly in Virginia's political sphere. Over the course of Carter's life, he was involved in buying and selling hundreds of slaves, which made him somewhat of a monetary prophet. By the end of his life, he owned 731 souls who were then separately willed to his many heirs. The descendants of these slaves found their way into many first family homes, notably the Custis, Washington, Carter, Lee lineage. Many were manumitted along the way, but many were not. We'll certainly come back to the most notable manumission from this line when we get to Robert Carter III. Slavery was but one portion of King Carter's business. His greatest economic interests lay in two areas, merchanting and planting. Robert quickly realized that there was an increasing demand for English and other European goods, if he could get his hands on them. To supply the demand, Carter leveraged his connections with many London merchants of his day. He already had a generations-old connection to the Bailey family, but Carter's favorite merchanting house was the ever-popular Perry and Lane. Robert's main focus was buying and selling at as rapid a pace as possible. So doing, he could move massive inventory for the best prices available. If such activity was deemed impossible by one merchant, Carter would then berate that establishment until they lowered their cost, or he would move on to find another merchant who would beat the formerly lowest prices available. No one, not even Mukajah Perry, withstood King Carter's demands. Carter simply commanded such economic influence that denying him short-term demands would severely damage any merchant's long-term bottom line. Carter knew this. So too did those who fueled Robert's supply lines. One can see Carter's methods on full display in a letter he wrote to the aspiring London merchant John Falconer in 1727. Carter told Falconer that, "Quick sales and returns is the life of trade. If you will but exert yourself in bringing my crops into a good reputation, I shall be very willing to let you into a large share of my business." How could any London merchant refuse such a proposition to, at that time, Virginia's wealthiest planter? To meet contracts, Carter offered his own as well as other less wealthy or able planters' goods on the market. He'd purchase those crops on credit, sell them to whichever outlet would pay best, and then pay those less able farmers, while making a profit for himself along the way. It was a win-win for all parties involved, unless, that is, a bad crop year plagued Virginia, which often happened. Understanding that crops could and often did fail, Carter expanded his operations into other ventures. He opened stores to sell local and English goods. He bought and sold slaves, as already mentioned. He operated a small fleet that he used to transport goods and people. He managed almost innumerable mills throughout the colony. And perhaps the latest non-planting-related venture King Carter began was mining. Governor Spotswood had spent countless hours and energy on establishing mining in Virginia. He famously transported many German families into the colony, who settled mostly around a fort they named Germana on the Rapidan River. Those German immigrants were brought to Virginia in order to mine the region. But after their indentures expired, many of them looked for other opportunities. King Carter recognized the situation, especially since he was approached by Spotswood and other leading figures who expressed their desire for Carter to invest some of his money into their scheme. Carter responded with indifference, stating that he was essentially too old to begin a new business. But secretively, He planned to begin his own mining venture with his sons Robert, Charles, and son-in-law Man Page at Frying Pan in today's Fairfax County. Sadly, for Carter and his progeny, the Frying Pan Company was an unproductive failure for all involved. The 27,000 acres purchased for the business never produced the copper and iron desired for manufacturing and exporting Virginian goods. There simply wasn't much or any raw material. On top of that, Carter looked to Wales instead of Germany for his mine workers. The Welsh proved to be a difficult lot who often found excuses to shirk responsibilities. Carter didn't live to see ultimate failure, but a man of his business acumen must have known it was coming. Though Robert had his hands in many money-producing businesses, his greatest cash cow was land. He inherited relatively moderate land holdings from his father and brother's respective wills. He also added a few acres after that, but nothing spectacular until fortune smiled upon him in a great way in 1701. Carter's lands were mostly confined to the Northern Neck region between the Rappahannock and Potomac rivers. This area became a proprietary gift of King Charles to seven of his supporters, who aided the would-be king after his father's beheading. The gift became real upon Charles' accession to the throne in 1660, which meant that those who owned land in the region were now forced to pay quit-rents to the proprietor in order to remain on that land. We'll talk in more detail about the Northern Neck proprietary at another time. But to suffice for now, the gift was not well received by those who were already living in the region on land they had already purchased, cleared, and settled. Governor Berkeley and many of his closest supporters, later including Robert Carter, argued against the grant and subsequent quit rent. Their protests fell upon deaf ears, however, and were even beaten back by some of their own, such as when Richard Lee II acknowledged the grant's legitimacy by the turn of the 17th to 18th centuries. Before Richard Lee II's support for the grant, the seven proprietors essentially narrowed down to one family, the Culpeppers, and eventually to just one, Thomas Culpepper. But after Culpepper's grant was renewed in 1688, he died, leaving the inheritance to his daughter and her husband Thomas Fairfax, 5th Lord Fairfax of Cameron. His son Thomas, the 6th Lord of Fairfax, finally inherited all shares of the grant in 1719. Though full control of the grant didn't fall under the Fairfaxes until 1719, the proprietors before that time collected quit rents from those living on their lands. In order to ensure collections of those quit rents, the proprietors set up tax collectors from Virginia elites. Men such as George Brent, Philip Ludwell, and William Fitzhugh held this lucrative position and began selling lands on behalf of the 5th Lord Fairfax in 1690. Still, considerable pushback remained the norm until William Fitzhugh's 1701 death left the proprietary's agency vacant. This is where Robert Carter realized his greatest potential. Carter sought the opening and, with the backing of men such as Richard Lee II, became the proprietary agent in 1702. With backing of distinguished landowners like Richard Lee, Robert Carter was able to use the proprietary to his advantage. Carter earned himself the name King because of his actions as the Fairfax agent. He was supposed to be doing business in their name, and he did, but Carter gobbled up massive land tracts for his family. In all, he patented more than 295,000 acres for himself, which were then distributed among his large family over many generations. It was such an astonishing amount that when Lord Fairfax read of his agent's 1732 death, he decided to send his cousin William Fairfax to replace the late Carter's position. William moved southward from Massachusetts and established his own plantation, Belvoir, along the Potomac River. The site was 4 miles south of Mount Vernon, where Fairfax's neighbors, the Washingtons, lived. Eventually, William's cousin, Lord Fairfax himself, moved from his Leeds castle and took up residence at Greenway Court between Front Royal and Winchester, Virginia. He then began managing his vast Northern Neck proprietary personally. Lord Fairfax's moving to Virginia was a major event in that he was from a family granted Scottish peerage status by King Charles I after Sir Thomas Fairfax of Denton's allegiance to Elizabeth, James, and Charles Stuart. The 6th Lord Fairfax's choice to move to Virginia was the only time a peer exchanged England for Virginia. Such were the riches accumulated and realized by Robert King Carter that they enticed an English lord to come to the colony permanently.
Be unbroken by and as a bitter home awaiting in the sky, Lord.
Carter's land holdings and business acumen were arguably eclipsed by his political savvy. He entered public life officially by first becoming a vestryman for Christ Church in 1690. The next office he occupied was Justice of the Peace for Lancaster County in 1691. Then came his appointment as commander of the militia for Lancaster and Northumberland, as well as his being named naval officer of the Rappahannock River. This naval position brought with it control over the customs office, which meant that he had direct control over the growing Northern Neck's finances as well as land purchases. Robert acquitted himself well with these early positions, which earned him further offices such as his being elected to the House of Burgesses in 1691 and 1692 for Lancaster County, and then again from 1695 to 1699. His position in the Assembly revealed just how powerful a figure he could be. Other leading members realized this potential and elected him first to the powerful committees for election and privileges and for examination of propositions and grievances. Before eventually serving as Speaker of the House, Carter chaired the Committee for Propositions and Grievances. He was also appointed to a committee responsible for revising the colony's laws. Carter then beat four challengers for the Speaker of the House of Burgesses position, which he became in 1696 and held until 1697. Though he may have lost the Speaker position, Carter was appointed Virginia's Treasurer in 1698, a position he held until 1705. Along the way, Governor Francis Nicholson took notice of Carter's growing importance and recommended Robert's appointment to the Governor's Council in 1699. By the end of the year, King William III's Privy Council approved the appointment, and Carter was sworn in on July 10, 1700. He remained on this august council until his 1732 death. Interestingly enough, when the leading colonial families of the time turned on Governor Nicholson, Carter too sided against the governor, which eventually led to Nicholson's being recalled. A decade later, another colonial governor, this time Alexander Spotswood, was deemed to be overstepping his authority by many of those same leading families. Carter again sided against Spotswood, which, just like before, saw the governor recalled. Though Carter was incredibly powerful, he earned enemies along the way. But by the 17-teens, he was too great a force with which to be reckoned. He remained on the council long enough to become a senior figure, second only to Edmund Jennings, his political foe. Jennings had opposed Carter on many occasions, and even took his Northern Neck proprietary agency for a decade. Jennings' political positions, as well as advanced age, accompanied with pressure from King Carter, led to his removal from the council just before Governor Hugh Drysdale's death. With Jennings gone, and the governor's office vacant, Robert King Carter was next in line to govern the colony until a new governor arrived. Thus, from August 1726 to September 1727, when Governor William Gooch arrived, King Carter was the acting governor of Virginia. Robert had reached the top. He was, arguably, far and away the most dominant man in Virginia of his era, other than perhaps the highly influential James Blair. What Carter might have lacked politically, when compared to Blair, he certainly made up with wealth and progeny in a way that Blair could not compete. Both men married well, even if Blair's wife, Sarah Harrison, famously said that she'd not obey him, but only Carter produced children with his two wives. In 1688, Robert first married Judith Armistead, daughter of John Armistead of Hesse Plantation in today's Matthews County. Armistead had been a prominent planter, as we'd already discussed in the Armistead episode, making his daughter a fine match for the aspiring Robert Carter. The couple had five children together, Sarah, Elizabeth, two Judiths, and John. Sarah and the first Judith both died within their first year. Elizabeth, the second born, but oldest surviving child, married Nathaniel Burrell, and then after his death, married George Nicholas. Nicholas is an interesting case study in his own right. Before coming to Virginia, he was found guilty of forgery and counterfeiting, a crime punishable by death. In fact, his accomplices were all hanged for their part, but somehow Nicholas escaped that punishment for himself. After spending time in Newgate Jail, he or someone in his family appealed the decision. The appeal worked, but Nicholas was ordered to transport himself to Virginia for the rest of his life. After arriving in the colony, he began calling himself a doctor and began practicing upon highly important clientele such as Governor William Gooch, who prized his work highly, even if he never took any degree, as the governor noted. 2 years after setting foot in Virginia, Nicholas somehow brown-nosed his way into Elizabeth Carter's good graces and married the newly widowed Carter in 1724. King Carter smelled a rat. He didn't like Nicholas and let Elizabeth know as much by calling the match imprudent and obstinate. To drive his point home, Carter stopped the income his daughter received from Merchant's Hundred Plantation and refused to attend their wedding. Further, though Carter reconciled with his daughter, he showed his eternal distrust of Nicholas by not naming George as an executor of Carter's will, thus making George the only son-in-law so unnamed. Elizabeth had 5 children with Nathaniel Burrell: Lewis, Carter, Elizabeth, Robert, and Judith, all of whom, except Judith, survived into adulthood and played important parts in Virginia's history. We've briefly looked at some of these figures in past episodes, such as Lewis Burrell, Carter Burrell, and Elizabeth Burrell Nelson. Elizabeth had at least 3 more children with George Nicholas: John, George, and Robert Carter Nicholas Sr. John and Robert Carter went on to feature prominently in Virginia, even starting their own prominent family lineage that lays claim to first family status. King Carter and Judith Armistead's third-born child, Judith, died in infancy. But as often happened in colonial Virginia, they reused the name when their 4th-born daughter entered the world. This Judith Carter survived childhood and became man page of Rosewell's beloved wife in 1718. Robert and Judith's youngest child was a son, John, who as a result became the chief inheritor of Robert's vast wealth. That's not to say that King Carter didn't make all of his children fabulously rich, however. John married extremely well in taking Shirley Plantation's Elizabeth Hill as his wife in 1723. Thus inaugurating the Hill Carter lineage that still owns the beautiful Charles City home today. His 4 children, John, Elizabeth, Charles, and Edward, produced future figures such as Light Horse Harry Lee and his son Robert E. Lee, to name but 2 key men from the now 12 generations of Hill Carters. Judith Armistead, Robert's first wife, sadly died in 1699 as he was rising into Virginia's highest circles. But Carter, the widowed father of 3 surviving children, wasted little time in remarrying, as he took widow Elizabeth Landon Willis as his second wife in 1701. This second marriage was much more prolific than the first, in that Betty, as she was known, bore Robert 10 children before her 1719 death. Anne Carter, the firstborn, famously wed Benjamin Harrison IV of Berkeley Plantation and produced the historically important Benjamin Harrison V. They were also grandparents of future President William Henry Harrison. She and Benjamin Harrison IV had 9 other children, some of whom we mentioned briefly in other episodes. They were Anne, Elizabeth, Robert, Lucy, Henry, Carter, Hannah, Nathaniel, and Charles. Second child, son Robert Carter II, lived to be only 28, but before his death he wed Priscilla Churchill from the important Churchill family of Wilton in Middlesex County. This was the first of many other connections linking the Carters to the Churchills directly and indirectly through other marriages. They had 2 children, Elizabeth and Robert Carter III of Nominee Hall. Next came Sarah in 1705, but sadly, she didn't survive the year. Thus, a second Sarah Carter died in infancy. Robert and Betty's next-born daughter, Betty, suffered the same fate as Sarah and died before her first birthday. Though death was ever present, Robert and Betty, however, continued trying and bore Charles Carter, later known as Charles Carter of Cleve, in 1707. Charles married 3 times, first to Mary Walker from Yorktown, with whom he fathered a son, Charles Jr. of Ludlow, and 3 daughters, Judith Walker, Elizabeth, and Mary. Second wife, 17-year-old Anne Bird, daughter of Westover's William Bird II, produced 8 children, Anne Bird, Maria, John Hill, Lucy, Landon Cleve, Jane Bird, Sarah, and Caroliana. After Anne Bird Carter's death, Charles Carter of Cleve sought another wife, even attempting to woo newly widowed Martha Dandridge Custis. After failing with Martha, Charles took his 3rd wife, the 16-year-old Lucy Tolliver, daughter of Caroline County's William Tolliver, in 1763. They had 1 daughter, Anne Walker Carter, who was just an infant when her prominent father died in 1764. Robert and Betty suffered an all-too-familiar fate with their next son, Ludlow, who died as a child. Their next-born son, Landon of Sabin Hall, however, survived childhood and became an important colonial and early American figure in his own right. He wed John Wormley and Elizabeth Ring's daughter, Elizabeth, in 1732. Together, Landon and Elizabeth had four children, Robert Wormley, Landon Wormley, John of Sudley, and Elizabeth Wormley Carter. All four children lived full lives and married prominently among Virginia's first families. After Landon's first wife, Elizabeth, died in 1740, he went on to wed another of William Byrd II's daughters, the 15-year-old Maria, in 1742. She died just over 2 years later after having only one child, Maria, who later married into the Beverly family. Landon then married his third and final wife, Elizabeth Beale, in 1747. He fathered five more children with Elizabeth before she too passed away in 1757. Those children were Judith Beale, Fanny, Lucy, Beale, and Susanna. Next of Robert and Betty's children was Mary, who wed Newington Plantations Major George Braxton II. Sadly, for George, his young wife bore him only two children, George and the important signer of the Declaration of Independence, Carter Braxton. Mary, as it was reported, caught a cold after burying Carter, and soon died thereafter. It was also reported that Carter, too, had caught the cold and died. But such reports were faulty, as Carter lived to see his Virginia become a leading component of the newly formed United States. Robert and Betty once again became parents to a daughter in 1715, who they named Lucy. True to form, Lucy married into another powerful family of her time, the Fitzhughes, when she became Henry Fitzhugh of Eagle Nest's wife. Before her first husband's death, Lucy gave birth to four children, Elizabeth, Anne, Lucy, and their son William Fitzhugh of Chatham, who we briefly discussed in the Fitzhugh episode. Lucy then went on to marry Nathaniel Harrison after Henry's 1742 death. Though she married into the Harrison line, her connection to the Fitzhughes meant that Eagle's Nest was home, and she was buried there after her 1763 passing. Final child born to Robert and Betty was George Carter, who died at 24 in 1742 before marrying and producing children of his own. Elizabeth Landon Willis Carter then died not too long after her youngest son George's 1718 birth. Robert never remarried, remaining a widower for the rest of his action-filled life. In all, Robert fathered 15 children with his two wives. 10 of those children listed above reached maturity, and 9 of them had children of their own. From those 9 came 60 grandchildren, 49 of whom reached adulthood and produced more King Carter descendants who did much to shape Virginia and the future United States. Because so many of those descendants feature prominently in Virginia's records, we'll have to pause for now and revisit them in more detail in the next episode. For now, it's hard to argue which facet of Robert Carter's life was the most important or influential. His economic understanding undeniably shaped the emerging colony into a powerhouse that dominated the New World for decades to come. Carter's political influence, both good and bad, also left an imprint upon the colony, in that new laws were created, policies were molded, and the first families came to control the royal colony in a way that other British colonies could only dream of. As a brief side note, we'll certainly go into greater detail about many of the events from King Carter's era and his important influence in many future non-First Family episodes. But though Carter's economic and political might were important, I'd argue that it was his familial contribution that mattered most. He imparted his business and governmental knowledge to so many close relatives that most of those who came after him figured prominently in the upcoming independence era and beyond. Robert Carter, in more ways than his peers, built upon Governor William Berkeley's foundation and established what it meant to be an 18th-century Virginia gentleman. His children paid attention to that, and they carried their father's ideals forward. Thus, without such figures as Robert King Carter, Virginia might never have emerged as powerfully as she did, and the great leaders and their ideas that came from her might never have been born.
Be unbroken by and by.
Thank you for tuning into the Virginia History Podcast. Your support is continuing to keep this colony growing. Please consider supporting us financially by first visiting our Patreon campaign at patreon.com www.patreon.com/VAHISPod. I also have a donation button set up on the website's support tab, as well as two online stores selling Virginia History podcast merchandise that can be found under the same support tab on the website. Visit often, as we're working to add more goodies to each store. You can also help us tell Virginia's history in a few non-financial ways as well. Start by subscribing to us on your favorite podcast app, and please take a few moments to leave us a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts. Doing so helps bring exposure in the podcast network. Then follow the podcast website at www.vahistorypodcast.com for show notes on each episode. And also look for us on social media. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. And finally, tune in again next time as we continue walking through Virginia's rich history. Do 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 do